Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sama Sambuddhassa. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sama Sambuddhassa. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sama Sambuddhassa. Theravada Buddhism series, Dhamma talk number 44. 40 ultra-mundane consciousness. 40 lokuttara citta. We have discussed 81 mundane consciousness and 8 ultra-mundane consciousness. In our past several talks, today we are going to discuss the 40 lokuttara citta. I will use the Pali word instead of ultra-mundane. The 20 path consciousness, megacitta, and 20 fruition consciousness, palacitta, make up the 8 lokuttara citta. 8 on the basic level, when expanded, it becomes 40. So, when expanded, this path consciousness or mega citta is called jhana mega citta. One more word. We don't simply say mega citta. We say jhana mega citta. So to understand this jhana mega citta, we need to go back and review what jhana citta is and mega citta is. Jhana citta is the mundane consciousness, mundane, attained through concentration meditation, samatha meditation, and it takes the concept, conceptual object of materiality and mentality as object of meditation. It has a maximum of 5, minimum of 2 jhana factors. I assume that you are familiar with all these words from the last few talks. I won't go back and explain again. And mega citta is the ultra mundane or lokuttara citta. Here it takes nibbana as an object, nibbana to contemplate, and it is achieved by practicing vipassana meditation on the true nature of mind and matter. Those two are entirely different. One is a concentration meditation. You use concentration meditation to the jhana citta. And you use vipassana meditation to attain mega citta. And it is sufficient to use simply mega citta when we are describing 8 Lokottara citta. If we want to just refer 8, saying the word mega citta is good enough. However, when expanded into 20 kinds, it is necessary to rename as jhana mega citta to explain the specific nature of each mega citta path consciousness. Here, it's important here, jhana mega citta does not mean jhana citta and mega citta arise together. It does not mean that at all. Because according to the law of consciousness, mentality, two different type of consciousness cannot arise together. So, jhana citta is one thing, mega citta is another thing. Entirely different. Different process, different object, different levels. Mundane, ultra-mundane. But a new term called jhana mega citta. That is the Lokottara citta. But when we want to discuss 20 types of mega citta, we must call that way jhana mega citta. So let's see how it comes about. So one is practicing vipassana meditation, and upon achieving all vipassana insight, you go through all the stages. At that moment, one attains mega citta, path consciousness. Before going through all the stages of vipassana, one cannot experience the path consciousness. And just for your information, this mega citta is associated with 36 chetasika mental formation. Chetasika mental formation, mental associates, altogether 52 of them. And here there are 36 chetasika arises together with this mega citta. Out of this 36, a few citta that we know, a few mental factors or mental formation or chetasika that we know is 8 from the Eightfold Path. 8 chetasika. Those chetasika, the right view, right thought. And so on. You know what it is. And the 5 jhana factors. Remember jhana factors? applied application, sustained application, joy, happiness, and one-pointedness. Those are the five mental factors. So those five plus eight from the Eightfold Path is already 13. Out of the 36, 13 are already there. I enumerate them because I'm quite sure you already know what they are. It is not jhana citta arising with mega citta. That's the most important thing. It is simply the occurrence of the five factors. Occurrence of the five factors of the jhana with mega citta. Mega citta arising, and in there are five factors. What we call jhana factors are there. It is not jhana citta is there. It is just the factors, qualities are there. The appearance of the five jhana factors in the part consciousness is due to the contemplation on the nature of mind and matter, the method, the object that you use. Here, you use the mind and matter, contemplation on mind and matter in mega. Jhana, you use things like kasina, okay, for the objects of concentration meditation. Totally different objects to contemplate upon. Those are the distinction. You still have this five jhana factors, but you get it by contemplating on the nature of mind and matter. That is the distinction. Yogi can attain the first mega and phala citta. Mega path, phala fruition. Yogi can attain the first mega and phala citta in a many different approaches or various ways. We'll discuss a few of them here. Those who practice pure vipassana or dry vipassana meditation, and they do not practice jhana at all. They go straight into the pure vipassana, no jhana. Those people contemplate on the nature of the mind and matter directly. And they have or they attain 36 mental formation, chitta-sika, when attaining the first mega or sotapatti citta. The first stream enterer, the consciousness of the first stream enterer. By practicing pure vipassana without any jhana, they attain the path consciousness with 36 citta-sika. And out of the 36, we already say the five. Vitakka, initial implication, vichara, sustained application, piti, joy, sukha, happiness, and ekagata, one-pointedness. Out of the 36, those five are there. When you become a sotapanna, you have these five mental qualities. As they have these five mental qualities, the first part consciousness resembles. The word is resemble. The first part consciousness resemble the first jhana citta of the fine material realm, rupa vasara realm, fine material realm, brahma realm. In terms of the five jhana factors, not the jhana itself, the factors, these five jhana factors, jhanas, are mostly arising in the fine material Brahma realm. And when you become sotapanna, you have all the qualities of those things, but not as a jhana consciousness. I'm stressing this point from various angles. Therefore, the first mega citta is called the first jhana mega citta. As soon as you get the path, okay, whether you put the name or not, the word jhana, you have the qualities of the first jhana with it for the first mega or path consciousness. So that's one way, straight, dry, pure vipassana. Some yogi practice vipassana by contemplating on miscellaneous mind and matter formation, which means you might be meditating on arising and falling of the abdomen, or the breath, or the feelings, pain, and so on. Those are called miscellaneous mind and matter formation of various types. In other words, you can use any one of these methods. Even though they have attained the first jhana. So the difference is, the dry one, they have no jhana at all. But the second group of yogis already have attained the first jhana. But they don't use it at all and go and observe the nature of mind and matter. And their mega citta will be exactly the same, which is the first jhana mega citta. Whether you go by the dry run or whether you have attained jhana and then the miscellaneous formation, the end results are same, the first jhana mega citta. And there's another method or another approach. Some, they have already attained the jhana. Okay. In other words, they practice concentration, meditation, and have attained first jhana. And what they do was, they enter into the jhana and emerge out of it. Get out of it. Purposely get into it and get out of it. And then contemplates on the five aggregates. With that approach, with that method, there are Megacitta is the same thing, the first jhana megacitta. It's just the different types of yogis approach different ways. Let's go to another approach. A yogi who already has attained first jhana, a yogi may enter the jhana and emerge out of it and practice vipassana. This time, he takes the first jhana citta as the object of meditation. He doesn't take formations or five aggregates. He takes the first jhana consciousness itself, use it as a object of meditation, and contemplate upon it to see the three characteristics in the jhana citta itself. So they don't observe too many objects, they observe the first jhana consciousness itself, contemplate upon it to see the anicca, dukkha, anatta. And they will achieve the same goal, the first jhana megacitta. So these are a few approaches based on the yogi's wishes, desire or capability. Without any jhana, you can get it. With jhana, without using jhana, you can get the same sotapanna. With the jhana, you contemplate upon the jhana consciousness itself, you can still become the sotapanna. And that sotapanna is called the first jhana megacitta. So we are only talking about the sotapanna, the first noble person, stream enterer. So as a stream enterer, okay, this sotapanna, they have the path consciousness. So depending on the predisposition of the yogi, some yogi have attained first jhana, some may have attained second jhana, some may have attained third jhana, fourth jhana, or even fifth jhana, because they practice jhana. So some have access to first, some second, third, fourth, fifth. Because of that, depending on the predisposition of the yogi in terms of jhana, when they attain the sotapada megacitta, one will be with first jhana megacitta, another person will be second jhana megacitta, third jhana megacitta, fourth, and then fifth jhana megacitta. So based on the association of the jhanic factors are different, there are five kinds of sotapanna. Five kinds of sotapanna. That's how one sotapanna become five based on the content of the jhanic factors. And similarly, you can apply the same principle to the Sakadagami, once returner. So Sakadagami Megacitta, they have the five kinds based on the quality of the jhana factors. And also anagami, non-returner. From one, it can expand to five based on the qualities of the jhanic factors. And finally, of course, arahata megha, destroyer of the all mental defilements. They also have five different types of arahata megha consciousness. And we have already said the first jhana megha citta associated with 36 mental formation or mental factors. The second associated with 35. The third with 34. The fourth with 33. And the fifth with 32. The fourth with 33 and the fifth with 33. Because whenever the jhana got higher and higher, the factors become less and less. First jhana, five factors. Second jhana, four factors. Third jhana, three factors. Fourth jhana, two factors. Fifth jhana, two factors. Because of that, these citta-sika, mental factors, become less and less. The higher you go, the less they become. We talk about the fourth and the fifth. They're the two jhana factors. Fourth and fifth only have two jhana factors. Why fourth and fourth, the same two? Because in the fourth jhana, there is happiness and one-pointedness, sukha and ekagata of the fourth rupa jhana accompany the fourth jhana megha citta. Happiness and one-pointedness accompany the fourth jhana megha citta. And in the fifth jhana megha citta, it's accompanied by equanimity and one-pointedness. Sukha, happiness is replaced by equanimity. They are different. But in terms of the jhana factors, they are the same two and two. And these two, megha citta resemble the jhana factors of the fifth rupa vasara jhana. Fine material jhana and arupa vasara jhana, immaterial jhana. They resemble that. They are not it, but they resembled it. Even though the full arupa jhana, in material jhana, are normally placed as 6, 7, 8, 9. The first rupa, material one, is 1 to 5. Immaterial is 6 to 9, 9 jhanas. Even though they are positioned like that, because of the types of objects and so on, or difficulty to practice, equanimity and one-pointedness. Okay. Equanimity and one-pointedness is called the fifth jhana, because fifth rupa jhana has two mental factors, and also fifth arupa, all arupa jhanas are called the fifth because they only have two mental factors. So they all fall into the fifth jhana factors. The same principle is valid for the palacitta, fruition consciousness. The full fruition consciousness palacitta can be expanded into 20 palacitta, the same way we had explained in the mega citta, based on the association with the jhana factors of the five kinds of jhana. So it's interesting to know four arupa jhana, when it looks from the point of jhanic factors, they are considered the fifth jhana, even though they might be called 6, 7, 8, and 9. A little extra information. The above is the simplest explanation of attaining different jhana mega citta or path consciousness, and how eight types of ultra mundane consciousness become 40 ultra mundane consciousness. We have gone through all 89 and 121 consciousness. The purpose of going through all these 121 consciousness and 52 types of chetasika, mental factors or mental formation. What's the purpose? Why do we go through there? It's to show that consciousness and mental factors are not a soul. It's not a self. But it's simply a mental phenomenon that operates with its specific law. Not random, very specific. We have gone through all these things so you can see their inner workings. Just like a machine, just like a computer, a mental computer, they are operating like a clockwork with all its rules and regulations and system. When it is operating like that, you can see that it is not a soul. You can see it's not a self, which we call atta. The understanding of these complexity of their inner workings and operation give you the understanding of the concept of anatta, no soul, non-self. The concept of anatta, no soul, non-self. Anatta is one of the three characteristics. Anicca is one, dukkha is another, anatta is the third. Anatta is one of the three characteristics of mind and matter. Or simply put, what we call a living being. Living being, that's why we said, or the Buddha said, there's no self and there's no soul. By intricately understanding all these in details, give you the understanding. This is not random. This is operating according to a specific law. We know the material law because of the physics and chemistry. No argument. But nobody can touch the mental law. And this is how Buddha explained us the law of the mind, consciousness and mental factors. By understanding it, number one, you come closer to understanding of the no-so, non-self. And also, by understanding these in detail about mind, about consciousness, types of consciousness, especially types of mental factors. For serious practitioners who are fairly advanced, you can screen your mind, you can screen oneself and figure out what kind of unwholesome consciousness are still with you, what kind of consciousness you have already abandoned, what kind of unwholesomeness that you need to work on. In a very specific nature, one can analyze oneself of the wholesomeness, unwholesomeness, things to abandon, and what things you have already abandoned, and walk your way through. And you can figure out where you are by yourself. You don't need anybody to tell you if you know how to gauge it. May all of you be able to practice mindfulness insight meditation, and may you be able to attain Ariya status as soon as possible. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Thank you very much.